Welcome to another episode of At the Table with Patrick Lencioni, where everything we talk about is related to changing the world of work so that more organizations can be more effective and less dysfunctional, and employees can be more fulfilled and less miserable. I'm your host, Pat Lencioni, and today I am not joined by my co-host, Cody Thompson. I've got my producer, Tracy Noble, in the house. Tracy, where is Cody?
Hi, Pat. Cody is actually out. He and his wife, Lindsay, just had a little baby boy yesterday.
Brooks,
yes.
Brooks Thompson, born at 1:44 in the morning yesterday. Congratulations, Cody.
Yes, congratulations.
We've given him 48 hours off, and he'll be back tomorrow morning.
That's
no, of
great.
Course not. But we congratulations to Lindsay and their whole family.
Yes.
And so we are flying without Cody today, and you're going to spin your microphone over to Chris Jensen, a guest we have, and Amy Hyatt, our general manager, who is in the house, right?
I am, yes.
Thank you, Tracy.
Thank you.
And that's our first announcement, and by far the most important one. Congrats, Cody and Lindsay. Our second one is a reminder that next Tuesday, August 4th, we are doing our first ever podcast webinar at 10 o'clock Pacific time in the morning. And Cody is going to be back for that for a moment. And so you're going to see me and Cody and Tracy and Chris will be here and a couple others. And we are going to have some fun taking your questions and talking to you about the podcast and other things related to it. Let's get into today's topic. Chris, what's today's topic?
Okay, today's topic is the work-life balance hack. The work-life balance hack.
So, yes. You know, for the older people, the hack is like when you cheat at something, you figure out how to use tinfoil to make your TV get better reception, or I don't know, that sounds like something from the 1940s. But so that's what a hack is. So since I've been in the workforce, I've always heard about the need to balance work and life. I've taken that for granted. Most of us have. We think about having to have the discipline to leave work at a certain time and avoid overinvesting in our jobs. But then again, not so much that we jeopardize our income. It's like a frustrating, never-ending game of back and forth. The challenge of work-life balance is even more complicated today, and it has been the last 5 or 6 months because of COVID, and we're in and out, and we're at home, we're back at work, and we're on Zoom. And we split our time between the office and home, but we can still do Zoom calls from home up until bedtime. We can take an hour to watch an episode of The Office in the middle of the day, and maybe no one's going to notice. And our kids are at home with us, and my kids are going to be home for the next 4 months, darn it, because they're not going to be able to go back to school. So we're home more, but we're disconnected from our families more. And so this whole work-life balance thing is crazier than it's ever been. And we were thinking about this the other day, and I think it's time that we started cheating at this game. And we started, instead of just trying to balance the balance sheet, if you will, of how many hours are we at work, how many are we at home, we should do something different.
That's right.
And so we think there's two ways to cheat the work-life balance conundrum, if you will. And the first one is, rather than balancing work and life, is to better integrate them. Make work part of home and home part of work. And it's something we've kind of done for a long time here at the Table Group, right, Amy?
Yeah, I was just going to say we've always been pretty good at this ever since. I mean, we've all grown up together and our kids were little together and now they're big together.
Yeah, Cody just had a baby. Remember, we were sitting around. I remember when you guys had your kids.
Exactly. But I think since COVID, we've learned a lot about how to even deepen those relationships and deepen the knowledge that that they know of what we do at work and what they're doing at home and sharing that with each other and giving each other advice, et cetera.
Yeah, when I think about work-life balance for me, my family has benefited immensely from me coming to work and interacting with people who actually know what's going on in my house and giving me advice.
Right.
Totally. You mentioned the word integration of work-life balance a couple podcasts ago, and it just stood out to me. And work-life separation or segmentation is, I think, typically people are trying to manage the trade-offs between that.
Right.
So I think this idea of integrating that, I think there's not a lot of clarity on what that means and how do we do that without... It feels like the bleed over is confusing.
Well, in fact, I think for years, and certainly me growing up, and this is a big reason why I'm in this field, is because it was expected that you did not integrate these things.
Right. Yes.
You were a good parent if you came home and didn't talk about work.
Right.
And
I
you
never
were a
really
good employee.
Understood that, to be honest.
Isn't it weird? We'd like, oh, dad was at work or mom was at work. I don't know what they do there.
Right.
And then we would go to work and we were expected not to bring home life into things. I mean, the other day we were on a podcast with some folks and one of the women on the podcast had her little girl on it. Mm-hmm. And I love that. I mean, I think it's so fun. And this wasn't employees here, but partners of ours. Yeah. And one of the people on the podcast didn't even acknowledge it. This cute little girl. And we were like, no, that's her life. I want to know more about.
Especially now.
Right. And so what I think we need to do is bring our home life, our personal life to work, and bring our work life home. Yeah. Right. My 14-year-old is asking me more than he ever has, how was work today, Dad?
That's right. Yeah. Every day I come home, Haley goes, hey, Mom, how's Pat?
Right.
Shout out to Haley. I appreciate that. I just love it.
She just is always interested in what Pat's doing.
And that makes my family feel more part of work. So when they go, oh, Dad was gone today, they're not like, he was doing some mind thing that they can't even imagine.
Right.
They're like, oh, I know what he was working on. How was the podcast today, Dad? Or how's the book coming? Or how did that one project you're working on with that client go?
They love being part of it. And anything we can share, like when Carter was able to come to an event with us before COVID, then that stays with them.
Yep.
And they are part of what we're doing. And it's so special. And exactly. I just want to encourage others to think of ways they can just incorporate their family even a little bit. Do you have any ideas on how to do that?
Well, I think we got to stop counting the number of hours we're gone.
Right.
Because if I work a 10-hour day, but I come home and I've got stuff to talk about. Mm-hmm. And so I sit in the kitchen with my family and we tell them about work. They actually like that.
Right.
When I was a kid, I wish I knew more. And I would go with my dad sometimes to work. He was a little bit like that too. But too often, I think he came home and just said, it's just frustrating. Mm-hmm. And then you're like, okay, I guess I'm not part of that part of your life.
Right. Yeah. And I know for me as an introvert, sometimes when I come home, I hesitate to talk about it because I'm already a little bit tired. But when I do, it always pays off because then they're part of my day and I'm part of theirs.
Yeah. Right. This is actually music to my wife's ears because when my wife and I first got married, we actually worked together. So accidentally, without any knowledge,
I forgot
it
that.
We worked at a church and she did the office. She was kind of the office manager and everything, our whole life work was totally integrated. And then I quit that and actually went and worked with a company based here in San Francisco. Mm-hmm. And it drove my wife crazy because I'd come home from work, I was exhausted, and I actually thought she didn't really care that much.
Right.
And it became a pain point in our marriage. And she's like, just tell me, like, give me like a 60-minute debrief when you get to the end of the day, when you get home.
Did you mean 60 seconds? I'm guessing if I know Asia, she meant 60 seconds, no, not
Asia
60 minutes.
Meant probably like 3 hours. Okay. She wanted me to go through every single actually, that was kind of what was hard. And I would say, over the last few years, this has been something that she's been more vocal about is tell me more about what's going on. And I to be honest, is something I've totally underestimated. I didn't think she cared that much.
Right. Mm-hmm. You know, and the funny thing is I get some of my best advice from home about what's going on at work.
Right.
Usually my wife takes everyone else's side. Right. I'm like, I'm having a problem with Amy. She's like, well, it's probably your fault.
Exactly. You know? Right.
Amy seems entirely reasonable. Yeah. So give me your story.
Exactly. Right. Yeah. The other day I was on the phone with one of our colleagues and I talked to him the way we talk to each other, which is very familial. And Rich overheard me and he was like, oh, I thought you were talking to me because it sounded like you were like yelling at him the way you yell at me. Anyway, it was funny.
Actually,
like,
I remember earlier.
I think that was a good sign.
Right, exactly. I remember earlier this year I was at your house, Pat.
Right.
And I was watching you and Laura after work talk about work. And I don't know if you remember me telling you.
Oh, yeah, you're standing in the kitchen.
This is actually really helpful for me to watch because Asia has been begging me to come home and have conversations with her like that. And I do think it is special when it happens in reverse, when I can come to work and Amy, you're like, how are the kids doing?
Yeah,
how's Bella?
Right.
How's Asia?
Well, we spent all lunch today giving somebody advice about their romance in a relationship.
Oh, that's the best.
And you know something? I will tell you, my family has benefited immensely from the fact that I can come to work and seek advice about things.
I mean,
Jackie, who's 20 years younger than me, she has given Laura and I real-time advice about our relationship. Like once we were driving around and Laura was mad at me and Jackie called for something. We're like, Jackie, how should we deal with this? And she's like, well, first of all, Pat, you're wrong about this. Laura, you need to be. And it's like, I love that.
Right. Or your advice about your kitchen remodel that I gave you last week.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. We had to postpone it because of COVID.
Yes.
And Amy was like, Laura is not going to do that kitchen remodel during COVID.
What do you think is the reason why people get uncomfortable at work? I mean, we talk about this with teams, like being able to talk about personal life is actually a good sign. And yet some people are really uncomfortable with that. I think even at home, sometimes it's uncomfortable.
Well, I think that it comes down to vulnerability. Boy, when you work with people that present their family as perfect,
right,
it's so uncomfortable.
Right.
Oh, my children are always great. Right. And man, I love it when Tracy will say, you know, Harrison did this. I'm like, oh, I'm so glad. Connor did the same thing. And right. we support each other.
Right.
Otherwise, how many years do people go to work and they sit and listen to people tell the perfect stories about their kids and they leave feeling like, man, my family is really a failure.
That right. doesn't help build trust, right? You
Not
have
at
to
all.
To get to know people even a little bit. You don't have to share all your deep dark secrets, but enough to know what's happening.
I think a lot of people think it's a distraction from getting work done.
Right.
We feel the opposite here, don't you think?
It actually saves time.
Well, you have to slow down in order to go fast. I mean, like if we come to work, Tracy has something going on in her family right now, a health issue. If we don't acknowledge that and we pray for her and we talk about that,
right.
there's no way she can be present in a meeting.
Right. Exactly. How could she focus if right. she's worried?
And it's not that we're being like callously like we need to increase productivity, right. but we care about her. We see on right. what's on her face. Let's help her deal with that. And even people were giving her advice and pass this along to your family. We did some research.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That makes everybody more productive. It makes us feel like I want to be there because people care about my personal life and I want to care about the work that we're doing. And
right.
this is doable in anywhere somebody yeah. works.
And I think early in COVID, one of the first things you put out there about advice to leaders, one of the aspects was to be personal, be more personal. Is that right. how you said
Exceedingly
it?
Human.
Exceedingly human. Yeah, that was it. I always get things a little bit wrong. So I just think this applies even more.
Yeah, I'm not sure that work-life balance will ever be quite the same.
Right.
Now, maybe the cure comes for this and everything goes back to normal, whatever that is. And 5 years from now, there'll be people going, yeah, I can't even remember what that was like. Maybe. I kind of think that we broke through mm-hmm. a glass barrier here where people mm-hmm. said, you know, I'm a human being. I'm going to bring that to work.
Right.
I'm going to bring my work home. I'm going
right.
to... I remember, like I said, the day I was in my office on a Zoom call and Laura yelled from the next room, watch your language! I slipped That's into a swear
or when word. You threw a pen at her. Remember when on the webinar and you threw a pen at the door because she was making noise?
Yeah, it wasn't at her. I didn't throw it at my wife.
I'm sorry.
Right. But like, right outside the door, I was in a webinar and there was some of the dog out there and a delivery person. Right, I was throwing a pen. So this is all part of how we live.
Right.
And I think the more we can integrate the two, the better we are. And we don't go home at night feeling like we've robbed our family.
Right.
We haven't robbed our family
right,
of that time.
That they're part of it.
Yeah.
They're part of our day.
So when we talk about team building and trust mm-hmm. in the five dysfunctions of a team and vulnerability and getting to know one another, it's so that not just we can get more done and trust each other at work, but so that our families can feel more integrated. And by the way, we love when people bring their kids to work.
Yeah.
Right. We have one here today.
Oh, is she?
Oh, she was. She was here earlier today.
Yeah, she was.
McKenna. Yeah.
And so, and we're all, people are always like, I'm so sorry. We're like, sorry, are you kidding? My whole perspective just changed.
Exactly.
Right.
And so this is something we need to do. So that's the first way to hack or cheat this work-life balance. Don't balance them. Don't separate them and try to do a balancing game. Integrate them and everybody will benefit. The second thing to do is find a way to make your work more fulfilling. Hmm. And that integration helps that. Mm-hmm. But if you're liking what you're doing at work and you're either living in your genius of work or you're making it fun and interesting for the people you work with,
right.
you will go home far more refreshed and positive.
That's
and
right.
I remember I had the worst job for me in the history of the world. Every summer during college, I was a bank teller. Now, anyone who knows me knows that that is the last job you should have me do. I don't think I ever balanced my till and because I was very...
Oh, but, oh my gosh.
But you know, I mean, they kind of knew that was fine.
But you were charming to those customers.
Well, you know what I did? I said, these other bank tellers aren't having as much fun as they should. And so I decided I was going to make it more fun for them and more fun for the customers. And people really liked it in the bank. Like I would play, they'd play Muzak, you know, that elevator music.
Right.
Mm-hmm. They take a song from the 70s exactly. or the 80s. A heavy metal song and set it to violins or something. And just, and I would in the bank, I would yell, I'd say to one of the customers, name that tune. And they would listen to it. We would crack up. Or when there was nobody in the bank, I would pretend like some of the little stanchions were robbers. And I made these little weapons out of rubber bands and paper clips and I would shoot them. And we would crack up. We'd go, okay, see if you can get that guy. And there was one lady that didn't like it, but that was my boss. But everybody else really liked it. And it made it more fun.
Right.
Totally.
Right.
And all of us can do this in our work.
Right. Yeah. When I was a waitress, I used to say, okay, I'm going to see how many tables I can go talk to in X number of minutes or what have you, just to make sure I was making contact. And it was just a little game I played with myself.
I used to, when I was a busboy, I don't know what this has to do with anything. I would hold my breath and see if I could carry a stack of dishes from one end to the other. I'd break into the kitchen. Like, oh my gosh.
All the ways we make work fulfilling.
Exactly.
Yes.
But the point is this. When we talk about balancing work and life, there's no way to balance a miserable job. If you go to work for 4 hours of misery every day, you're not going to come home feeling balanced. If you go to a job that where you love what you're doing or you make it fun and important for others. And speaking of the waitress thing, a really good friend of ours was a waitress when she was in grad school.
That's right.
And she and her colleagues used to complain all the time about their job. Mm. Like, oh, that lady's going to stay late. Oh, look, her kids made a mess and all these things. And her manager pulled her aside one day and said, listen, I know this isn't your career forever, but see all these people here? They all have a story.
Right.
There's something going on in their lives. Oh, your job is to make their stories cool.
Right.
And to make them better and find out what they are.
Right.
Yep.
She said that's the day they stopped complaining. And during their breaks, they would go, see that lady over there? That's her twin sister. They're 75 years old and they haven't seen each other for 10 years. That lady over there, she hasn't eaten out for 3 weeks. And mm-hmm. this is her only chance mm-hmm. to eat something that she didn't have to cook. And they were finding out about the stories. You know they went home
yeah.
feeling better about their work.
That's right.
Than when they were complaining about
right.
it. Because totally. They found a way to make it meaningful.
Right.
That's right.
Which is really important because there's definitely seasons when at work, it's really stressful and hard. Even if it's something you love doing.
Oh, yeah.
There's
oh,
times
yeah.
when it's really, really difficult.
I'm in that right now.
Yes.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, we all
and
are.
I'm mm-hmm. overwhelmed. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, I love everything about my job and I have way too much of it. I'm starting to get cranky.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And every day my wife asks me, but is this what you love doing? And I'm like, yes, I love this. It helps her to know how to support me because otherwise she'll feel my stress without me being willing to share that with her and affirm like how important this is and really bring those two worlds together. She's left carrying a burden
yep.
that she probably doesn't actually need to carry. Once she hears me say, it is really hard. I am really stressed, but I love doing
this. I'm having fun.
And she's like, great.
Or here's what went well today. Or here's a conversation I had that was hard, but it mattered.
That's right. Otherwise she carries the stress.
Right.
And you guys actually do the same thing. We do the same thing here. If things at home are really stressful,
yeah, mm-hmm.
it's so important for me to be able to share, like, here's what happened.
Right.
You know, we yeah. got an argument or the kids are going crazy.
Right. Well, especially you right now with your move and all that. It's exactly. very yeah, stressful.
Actually, you asked this on the other day on our morning check-in. You said, Chris, send pictures to us so we can see what your house looks like, just mm-hmm. so we can have a picture of your world
what
at
you're
home.
Dealing
we
with.
Want to understand the stress and just get up so we can be there with you.
Because on your Zoom call, it's perfectly lit and it looks totally normal. And everywhere around you said it's chaos.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, we need to see that chaos.
You need to see it. Right. And that actually has an impact on not just me, but my family to hear, gosh, everybody wants to be a part of this.
You know, I got to tell you something. This is talk about integrating work life. I have a 14-year-old, 17-year-old, and two 22-year-olds. I ask advice about work from my 17-year-old. Mm. And obviously that sounds kind of silly, but yeah, it's like, first of all, I want him to feel a part of it. Secondly, he has a perspective.
Oh yeah.
A 17-year-old will, and I'll be like, hey, Casey, I'm struggling with this and this person, and this is what's going on. What do you think? And he'll go, well, what about this? And more times than not, it's something I hadn't thought of that way. He has right. a different perspective. And I know he actually enjoys thinking that he might have something to offer.
And leave it to your teenage kids to tell you the truth about something, right?
Oh, yeah.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah.
Exactly.
And now we have one of your 22-year-olds with us.
Working here.
And as of yesterday, and it's just so fun to hear their thoughts, too. And they're so new, but they have great ideas.
It's nuts how we limit the input we get from people right. because of their age or their right. experience. And in fact, those are the people we really need to get. In fact, one of them said today, Liam said to Matt, I'm afraid to share my opinion. This is his second day at work.
Right.
Right.
And Matt outed him.
Said, yeah.
Yeah. Liam's afraid to share his opinion. Right, right. And we were like, no, we want to hear all of your thoughts yes. right now, because someday you're going to get used to this like us and your perspective
exactly.
will be less will be, novel.
Right. Exactly.
That's right. That's yeah. right.
So this work-life balance thing, I don't think it ever worked. I don't think that it especially doesn't work today.
I've never understood it, to be honest.
Right. So integrate it, make it fulfilling so that when you go home, your life is just part of work. Your work is part of life and everybody is more satisfied that
way.
That's
right.
That's right.
That's right.
All righty.
Hey, does it make sense to tell these folks about Kappa Pro?
Let's do it, Amy. So Kappa Pro is a new program we have. Mm-hmm. I think we mentioned it once before, but it's great to remind people. If you're a practitioner of organizational health, HR, anything like that, anything. Or you're a consultant, mm-hmm. internal to a company, outside of a company, you have your own consulting firm.
You do trainings, coaching,
training and development,
organizational consulting,
and any of that.
This could be one of the things that, what made me think of it is if you're passionate about making work more fulfilling, this is one way to do it.
Very good point, Amy.
No.
I mean, seriously, that's a very good point. Once a day, yay, Amy's out of here. And so she has many more than that. And so this is an opportunity to, we're launching this program starting September 1st called Kappa Pro, where you can be part of a network, an alliance, and you pay $8,500. And if you can't pay, don't pay us until you can afford it, but join it September 1st
right.
and get on board. And we will be doing twice a month, like webinars and training, and we will be sending out information. You'll have access to all of these great tools and training videos, and you'll have a way to get questions answered from us. If you're starting a practice or you have a practice and you want to grow it, or you work within a company, you want to be better at it.
Right.
Kappa Pro is what we're doing to try to equip. We want thousands of people to be doing organizational health
right.
inside and outside companies.
We should say one of the unique components of this is we're actually helping anybody who's a part of this with every bit of content we've ever brought to the world of work.
Right.
This is
everything around
back.
Organizational health. So this is all the teamwork stuff, organizational clarity, all of that. It's all of the work that you've done around leadership and management. And I mean, you've done
25 years of experience pretty much of doing this.
I mean,
this.
You've got books on this stuff, and we've never really integrated all this into one
training program
to help equip people who want to use this. And I think for us to be able to bring all of this experience and say, we're going to teach you everything. We're going to give it all to you, train you, and we think you're going to be more successful. You're going to be more fulfilled doing it, and you'll be part of a whole community of people who are passionate about something that you believe in.
Right. So go to our website, tablegroup.com/Kappa Pro.
It's also just on the homepage.
Okay.
Yeah.
And check it out. It starts September 1st, and we're going to be launching it with some really cool events. We're going to have an annual event that people can come to, and lots of cool stuff. Yeah. And we're going to be releasing this really new program around personality and work.
That's right.
It's really exciting.
I would say, because a lot of leaders listen to your podcast, any leaders who you know you have HR folks who you want helping you
With in your organization.
Right.
You might want to recommend them to be a part of this and look into this, because it's a very convenient way for anybody who supports you as a leader to get the equipping and tools
and
to serve you better.
And ongoing new material. We're going to be producing original content just exclusively for this program.
That's right.
So we're very excited about it. Chris, thank you for joining us today, filling in for Cody.
I did my best, but who can replace Cody?
No, I know it. I know
did
it.
Did a great job.
Thank you for being here. We
thank
really
you for
appreciate
having
it.
Me.
Tracy, holding down the fort for us. We will talk to you next week on Tuesday on our webinar. We'll also be doing a podcast next week as well. God bless you, everybody. Talk to you soon.